to the Unit Podcast. My name is Olivia, and I'm sitting here with Maddie, Craig, and Leah, and we will be meeting our other group member, Justine, at a later episode. We are the series on advocacy and awareness for LGBTQ rights. This is our first podcast of our series with three more episodes to follow. We want to make our community a more understanding place to in turn create a better you and I. For the first part of our four-part series, we'll be discussing current events centered around the topic of LGBTQ. We're going to turn our heads and hearts to a more somber mood and then boost spirits at the end. So let's begin by talking about a current topic we have all no doubt been keeping up with, whether we want to or not, Coachella. Coachella is currently going on, and if you have been anywhere near social media, specifically Instagram, then you know that it's going on. Even though that it's 2019, there's still the typical culture appropriation with what everyone is wearing that is always topical to discuss and dissect, along with the artist performances and celebrity outfits. However, the major topic of discussion this Coachella season isn't what Vanessa Hudgens is wearing. It's where people's Coachella money is going, a right-wing billionaire who funded anti-LGBTQ causes. A 2016 report on America's enemies of equality is often cited as blowing the lid off Coachella and its founder, Philip Anschutz, the owner of entertainment conglomerate AEG. The Freedom for All America's campaign reported that Anschutz, one of the richest people in America, with a net worth of $12.9 billion, gave large sums of money to the Alliance Defending Freedom, the National Christian Foundation, and the Family Research Council. According to the article from the Washington Post, the National Christian Foundation funds a lot of the groups aggressively working to chip away at the equal rights of LGBT Americans. The Family Research Council, which expressively says on its website that, quote, it believes the homosexual conduct is harmful to the persons who engage in it and to society at large, has been deemed an extremist group by the Southern Poverty Law Center. In 2017, Afropunk published a blog post urging would-be Coachella goers to think twice before selling their souls to see Beyonce. Eventually, the pressure to hashtag boycott Coachella got so bad that Philip released a statement insisting that, quote, recent claims published in the media that I am an anti-LGBTQ are nothing more than fake news. It's all garbage, end quote. Fans were left in morally murky waters, choosing between a boycott and a Beyonce show. More than a year later, not much has changed. Beyonce is finally going to headline Coachella. So what are you guys' thoughts on Coachella?
I think it's going to be around for probably a bit longer. We're also in the age of, like, SJWs, so social justice warriors, and holding people accountable. And we see that a lot through, like, Twitter. And so, like, we're in this cancel area. So, like, maybe Coachella will soon be, like, canceled, but until then, obviously, people are still there right now, so not a lot of thought is going into it.
I'm so surprised that this is, like, the first time that we've heard about this. Coachella's been happening for a while. I've seen it on Instagram and on social media for a couple years, and it's taken this long for it to become something, but I'm glad that these social justice warriors have brought it to our attention, and hopefully it'll get these people to want to make change.
I agree that we're kind of this generation, I guess, we're kind of all about cancel culture right now, which in itself is kind of problematic. But when it brings out actual, like, problematic things, it's great. So, unfortunately, I don't think Coachella is gonna, like, end anytime soon, because it's just so big. It's good that, like, this is, like, getting out, I guess. It's great.
Olivia, that was a really interesting story about Coachella. That's something that we usually don't think about, and I'm glad that the news brought around this really important issue. Now, Leah, I know that you also have a really interesting story for us.
Yeah, thank you. It's about Brunei, which is a small country kind of within the areas of Malaysia and the Philippines and Indonesia, kind of like in that small collection of islands, passed a law that would allow the punishment of gay sex by public stoning. Brunei has always been a very conservative country, so homosexuality and gay sex, I guess, has never been legal in the country, but it was originally punishable by 10 years in prison, and now it's gone up to this. It went into effect on April 3rd, so it did pass, unfortunately. But before it being passed, there was a lot of pushback on social media, of course, but also by Amnesty International, which is a human rights organization out of London. And a researcher from Amnesty International is quoted saying, "To legalize such cruel and inhuman penalties is appalling of itself. They should not even be deemed crimes at all, including consensual sex between adults of the same gender." So this is, like, not a great thing that's going on right now in Brunei, but what are you guys' thoughts on it?
I remember seeing this posted by Ellen on Instagram, and I just remember thinking that it's 2019 and stuff like this shouldn't be happening anywhere, and it really frustrated me because I mean, you don't want to believe this stuff, but it's out there. It's just, it's not always brought to our attention, and I'm glad that other people like Ellen and people do post about it just so we can be aware of what's going on around us and how much work there still is to be done.
Something that I'm scared for is to see if, like, they even go through with this, you know, because somebody has to be the first person, somebody has to go through this, and hopefully all these people can be safe there or get out in time to go somewhere else where they can be safe.
Definitely. So when you shared this story, I thought that we were in a time machine. This is something that we hear in textbooks. Unfortunately, this is something that still happens in 2019. And as Americans, with the marriage being legal and it being fairly accepted in most communities, we think of this as LGBTQ rights. Well, this is something we've already achieved, and that the oppression of this community is in our past. But unfortunately, with this story, it shows that our fight is not over and that we need to continue fighting for LGBTQ rights. Thank you so much, Leah, for sharing that story and opening our eyes to LGBTQ rights that are beyond America and beyond just where we are. It's really great to see that there are opportunities for social change. Although this is a horrible and terrible thing, this is an opportunity for us to advocate for people that are not only in our country, but all around the world. So our next story Craig has for us, feel free to share your new story with us, Craig.
So this story is actually a little bit exciting. New York Times reads, HIV is reported cured in a second patient, a milestone in the global AIDS epidemic. So what has happened is we saw that there's a patient in London, and he has been off of the medication taken to suppress HIV and is living a full HIV-free life. And so both of these milestones resulted from bone marrow transplants given to infected patients. So these transplants were actually initially intended to treat the cancer in the patient and not do anything to their HIV at all. But what they're seeing now is that these two patients, who are almost 12 years apart to the day, are living HIV-free and living a healthy life. And so right now, the title is a little bit misleading. It may be too early to say that this is a cure, just because they've only been able to replicate this once. But this is huge, because right now in the U.S. alone, 1.1 million people are living with HIV, and approximately 15% of them are unaware that they are even infected. So this is something that, it's important here, it's important in other countries. This is really big things. We already have PrEP for people to use who may be at risk for contracting HIV, and there's medication for people to take that makes their viral load non-transferable. So we already have PrEP for people to use who may be at risk for contracting HIV, and there's medication for people to take that makes their viral load non-transferable. And in fact, some cool things right now that are happening is there's a Unity Point in Des Moines at the Methodist Hospital that just opened up, and it's the first of its kind to be, like, fully inclusive of the LGBTQ community as a whole in the metro area. So they offer dedicated health services for the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, questioning, and queer communities in a comfortable and welcoming environment. Every member there has had specific LGBTQ training, and also through one Iowa Safe Zone training.
Thank you for sharing, Craig. If it weren't for Freddie Mercury, HIV wouldn't be on my radar, because no one talks about it, as it isn't prevalent as much anymore these days. But that's not the case at all. There are still numerous people living with HIV.
I definitely think that is super relevant, and it's actually really exciting to hear that HIV now may be something of the past, and that although people can live having HIV with that cocktail of several drugs, so that they can have a more comfortable life, and how HIV is not a death sentence. I definitely think that there needs to be more advocacy on prevention as well as education on how do you contract this disease. But I'm really glad that we're taking a lot of steps with modern medication to create a better life with HIV.
Yeah, I think we're not at the cure stage yet, but it's great that we're getting these results so that we can, you know, work towards a cure and, you know, help people who have it, and definitely work on education and stuff for those who maybe don't have it or don't know they have it. Yeah, I think that's great. Thank you.
Well, now we're going to discuss our last article of the day, which is Maddie. It's a good transition point from politics.
It sure is a great transition for politics. Well, my name is Maddie, and today I'll be talking about the LGBTQ Democratic candidate for the 2020 president election. Now, I've been researching on several websites, but the website that I've used the most is called The Washington Blade, which claims to be America's top news source for all things LGBTQ, and what they have to say about his speech saying that he's running for president. On April 4th of 2019, Peter Paul Montgomery Buttigieg declared that he'll be running as a Democratic candidate for the 2020 presidential election. Pete is a 37-year-old. And he has been mayor of South Bend, Indiana since 2012. He was a former naval intelligence officer and a graduate of Harvard, where he studied history and literature. He also studied at Oxford University. Pete is also a proud advocate for the LGBTQ community. He was accompanied by his loving husband of 1 year, Chasden Glensman, when he was giving this speech. He would be America's first openly gay president. This is a quote from Pete. When a reporter asked me if America is ready for a gay president, I'm going to tell the truth, he said. I will give them the only honest answer I can think of, and this is it. I trust my fellow Americans, but at the end of the day, there's exactly one way to find out for sure. Vote for me. The LGBTQ community has started crowdfunding for Pete's campaign efforts. In terms of policy, he said that he is prepared to sign a Federal Equity Act right away to ban anti-LGBTQ discrimination, and has denounced President Trump's transgender military ban. Pete was invited to give a speech at the brunch for the LGBTQ Victory Fund. The crowd attending the Victory Fund brunch consisted of 820 people, predominantly members of the LGBTQ community. During the speech, Pete recounted his awkward teenage years and his struggle for being in the closet, especially as a politician and as a student and as a gay youth. This is a great advancement for political advocacy in the LGBTQ community and the Democratic Party. What do you guys think?
I think this is great. I think it's about time, especially with our previous president, Barack Obama, being the first African-American president. I think it's great to have a LGBT candidate, and then hopefully president, I guess. But just having a candidate is a great step forward for the LGBT community.
I agree. There needs to be a more diverse representation for marginalized people on that spectrum. So.
Well, I think this would be really cool, given the circumstances that we're in now. There's definitely conversations being brought up about, like, hate and differences between people. But I'd be interested to see Pete's take on the issue and hopefully bring up some instances of intersectionality and start the conversation about that, too.
Thank you, Maddie, for sharing your article. So that wraps it up for our first podcast for the unit. If you'd like more information and resources on LGBTQ, visit oneiowa.org. One Iowa advances, empowers, and improves the lives of LGBTQ Iowans statewide. Thank you.